Chapter 1. We live in a world of copycats. Children have never been very good at listening to their elders, but they have never failed to imitate them. One of the first books I remember reading as a kid was a joke book. I can still remember one of my corny jokes that used to crack up my friends and me. It takes money to make money. You have to copy the design exactly. Hey, I told you it was a corny joke, didn't I? But the sentiment is that serious. Why haven't we found a way to copycat creating wealth? Think about it. We copycat everything else in our lives, don't we? But the only thing we haven't learned to copycat is creating true wealth. Let's take a few moments to talk about the power of copycatting, and then we'll look at some of the reasons most people haven't found a way to copycat wealth creation. One thing we are all good at is copycatting. Each of us is blessed with certain talents and gifts that make us one-of-a-kind individuals. Some people are great dancers, while others can't tap their feet to the beat. Some of us have a talent for art, while others have trouble drawing a stick figure. Some of us are great athletes, while others can barely walk a straight line without stumbling. But the one thing each and every of us is good at, without exception, is copycatting. Have you ever thought about how good we are at copycatting? When it comes to copycatting, we are all gifted. We are copycat geniuses. Copycatting is one trait that we all excel at and that we all have in common. No matter where we live, no matter what our individual talents are, it makes no difference whether we are rich or poor, black or white, male or female. The one thing we are all great at is copycatting. So why haven't we found a way to copycat creating wealth? Copycats from the cradle to the grave. Copycatting starts the day we are born. We copy the language we speak, the food we eat, the way we wear our hair, the way we walk, the way we dress. When we enter school, we learn to read and write by copycat letters in the alphabet. If you were born in Western culture, you copycatted the system of writing from the left side of the page to the right. If you were born in parts of Asia, you copycatted writing from the right to the left. As we grew older, we learned to drive a car by copycatting, didn't we? The instructor showed us how to check the rear mirror, turn on the turn signal, push slightly on the gas pedal, drive the speed limit, and come to a full stop at intersections. The better we were at copying our driving instructor, the easier it was to pass our driver's test. When in Rome, do as the Romans do. We are so good at copycatting the people around us that we are often shocked by the customs and the habits of people from different cultures. That's what the expression, when in Rome, do what the Romans do, is all about. It's a plain way of saying that we need to honor and respect different cultures, especially when we are visiting other countries. But that's a lot easier said than done. We get so comfortable with copycatting the customs around us that we are often amazed and amused when we hear what other cultures are copycatting. This short list of the favorite snacks of TV watchers around the world will show you just what I mean. United States, popcorn. China, chicken feet. Japan, tea sandwiches. Mexico, ears of roasted corn. India, mutton sandwiches. Korea, sun-dried squid. Did you think to yourself, how could they eat that? Sun-dried squid, chicken feet? You have got to be kidding. But guess what? You'd probably be snacking on while you watch TV if you grew up in Korea. That's right, sun-dried squid. Copycatting the way we work. Here's my point. There are countless differences between cultures, but the one thing every single culture has in common is the way we go about learning the customs we practice. We copycat. We copycat so much that we take it for granted. Copycatting is so prevalent that it's second nature to us, like breathing air. So I ask you again, why haven't we found a way to copycat creating wealth? Make no mistake about it. Copycatting is the most powerful learning tool known to humans. Copycatting impacts virtually every single phase of our lives, from our smallest habit to our biggest life-altering decisions. For example, we spend a big part of our lives at work. Did you ever stop to consider how you learned to perform the task you perform at work? How did you learn to write a letter on the computer? How did you know what to wear to the office? How did you teach others who were new on the job? By teaching them to copycat what you did. Isn't that true? The psychologists call it modeling and mirroring. I call it being a professional copycat. No question, we copycat our way through life from the cradle to the grave because copycatting is easy to do. We don't have to keep creating everything from scratch all the time. It works, and we are born geniuses at it. The expression monkey see, monkey do could just as easily be people see, people do. That's why I say we live in a world of copycats. If there's one thing every single person in this world is good at, is copycatting. A short history lesson on copying jobs. We even go so far as to copycat how we earn money. For thousands of years, children of farmers copycatted their parents and become farmers. Children of shoemakers become shoemakers. That's why so many of our last names come from the trades. Names like farmer, smith, carpenter, tailor, and so on. With the advent of industrial revolution, millions of children with last names like farmer, smith, carpenter, and tailor broke away from the family trade and headed to the city to copycat a new concept of work, the job. Copycatting the job worked pretty well for several generations, especially in America. The undisputed king of the industrial revolution, because the first half of 20th century was overshadowed by two world wars and the Great Depression. Most people were overjoyed to copycat their family and friends and work a 9-to-5 job. And as long as people's expectation didn't exceed their standard of living, people who copycatted the gotta get a job mentality, be content with what they had. Think before you copycat. Like most everything in life, there's a flip side to copycatting. Just because we copycat something doesn't necessarily make it good or efficient or productive. Unfortunately, all too often copycatting is an excuse to get lazy in our thinking. It reminds me of the story about the old shopkeeper on the main street who placed a grandfather clock in front of window of his store. Over the years, the shopkeeper noticed that a dustbin distinguished looking man would walk by the store every day at noon, pause in front of grandfather clock, pull out a pocket watch and carefully set the time. One day the shopkeeper's curiosity got the best of him. When the gentleman paused in front of grandfather clock, the shopkeeper ran out of the store and asked the man why he set his watch each and every day. The man smiled and replied, "I am the foreman at the town mill," he said. "I blow the quitting whistle at 5 each day and I want to be sure it goes off exactly on time." The old shopkeeper gave him a startled look and then burst out laughing. The man stepped back and asked indignantly, "What's so funny?" "I'm sorry," replied the shopkeeper. "I didn't mean to be rude, but I just had to laugh. You see, all these years, I've been setting my grandfather clock to your 5 whistle." This story is a perfect illustration of the downside of copycatting. We copy others, others copy us. And all too often, we assume that people we are copying have the right answer. I repeat, we assume we are copying the right people. That's exactly what happens when we take a job without really thinking why we took the job. I think most people assume that jobs are the best way to create wealth. Well, in fact, jobs don't create true wealth. Jobs create temporary income, and there's a big difference between the two. Let's re-examine copycatting the job. Like I said earlier, copycatting is the most powerful learning tool known to humans. But every now and then we have to step back and examine our assumptions about what we are copying and why, to make sure copycatting will indeed give us what we think it will give us. Throughout this chapter, I repeatedly asked the question, why haven't we found a way to copycat creating wealth? The answer is painfully obvious. Most of us have been copycatting the job track instead of the wealth creation track. Why? Because most people assume that a job is the only way to actualize their financial dreams. Perhaps they are unaware of alternatives to the job. Perhaps they don't believe there are other sources of wealth, or perhaps they don't think they are capable of creating true wealth by working outside job routine. Whatever the reason, the result is the same. Most people become 95% years instead of 5% years because they are copycatting the job track and creating temporary income instead of true wealth. What about you? What are you choosing to copycat? Are you choosing to be like 95% of the people who are copycatting the job track, or are you choosing to be like the 5% who are copycatting the wealth creation track? Get off your assumptions. As a wise person once observed, your mind is like a parachute. It only works when it's open. Today, more than ever before, it's imperative that we open our mind and become aware that jobs are a system for income creation, not wealth creation. I believe that if people are serious about getting ahead in life instead of getting by, then they have to get their assumption and open their minds to alternative ways of creating wealth. I believe that the 95% years, that is, people who continue to enter the door marked job, will continue to end up right back on the street where they started. I believe, however, then if we are truly sincere about getting different results and becoming 5% years, we need to start entering doors that will open to wealth creation. In the next chapter, we'll talk more in depth about the difference between income creation and wealth creation. And we'll learn why true wealth is more attainable today than ever before in history. Chapter 2. What is true wealth? If you have to tell people you are rich, you ain't. What does it mean to be wealthy? I mean truly wealthy. Certainly the word wealth means a lot different things to a lot different people. To me, wealth isn't just about being able to buy things, although that's a nice side benefit. To me, true wealth is synonymous with freedom. Here's my personal definition of wealth, and I think it pretty much captures the biggest benefit of wealth. Wealth is having enough money and enough time to do what you want and when you want. Do you think Bill Gates, who is worth billions, keeps his job as CEO of Microsoft because he has to or because he wants to? I think it's safe to say that Bill Gates has enough money and enough time to do what he wants, when he wants, because Bill Gates has created true wealth, not just income. In a word, true wealth is freedom. Wealth means freedom to choose. Chuck Finney is in the same financial league as Bill Gates, as the founder of hundreds of duty-free shops in airports all over the world. Finney is worth billions, or I should say, he was worth billions. In 1984, Finney donated 99.9% of his $3.5 billion fortune to a charitable foundation. Today, he is donating his time and his money to worthy causes all over the world. Both Bill Gates and Chuck Finney understand that true wealth means having total freedom to choose how to spend your time and your money. Gates is choosing to spend his time creating more wealth, while Finney is choosing to spend his time giving his fortune away. The common denominator that enables these two men to make two very different choices is true wealth. Spend your time wisely. Most people think true wealth is having lots of money so you can buy material things. But the wisest people understand that true wealth isn't so much about having more things, as it is about having more time to do what you want to do. Think about it. When you are old and grey, sitting on the front porch of a nursing home, contemplating how you lived your life, what are you most likely to regret? Not buying a more expensive home or not spending more time with your kids when they were young? What are you most likely to regret? Not working around the clock for the promotion at the office, or not spending more time with your parents and your friends when they needed you? Time is our most precious commodity, far more precious than gold, because once it's gone, you can never get it back. If you break your car, you can always buy another car. If you lose your job, you can always get another job. If you lose money in a bad investment, you can always make more money. But you can never get back the time you lost or misspent, can you? Once it's gone forever. An ancient Chinese proverb says it best: better to throw all your fortune down a deep well than to squander one moment of time. That's why I say true wealth is having enough money and enough time to do what you want, when you want. Without a doubt, the biggest benefit of true wealth is having the freedom to choose how you spend your time. Income creation, the time for money trap. Have you ever known any hardworking doctors or lawyers who make upwards of $1,50,000 per year, but they feel trapped? Are they creating true wealth? According to my definition of wealth, the answer is no. Here's why. Even though many highly paid professionals have the money to buy and do what they want, most do not have the time, because they have to keep working at their jobs day in and day out. In effect, they have to work to create income so they can maintain their lifestyles. People who are locked into their jobs, no matter how much or how little they earn, are victims of income creation, not wealth creation. With income creation, you trade your time for dollars, which means you don't earn money until you personally do the work. Whether it's a garbage collector earning the minimum wage of $5.15 per hour, or a heart surgeon earning $5,000 per hour, income creation is still trading a unit of time for a unit of dollars. With income creation, 10 hours of work equals 10 hours of pay. Unfortunately, income creation is an endless treadmill. That's why I call income creation the time for money trap. Worst of all, when the treadmill stops, the income stops, which means that workers who fall victim to illness or injury or long layoffs or burnout are income less. When the outgo equals to the income, Let's take a look at a typical rich professional. Let's call him John Smith, MD, with an annual income of $150,000. By almost everyone's standard, $150,000 a year is a lot of money. But when highly paid professionals become dependent on their incomes to support their lifestyle, they become unwitting victims of the time for money trap, slave to temporary income. As you can see, Dr. Smith lives a pretty nice lifestyle. We'd all love to have the money to join a swanky country club, to take expensive sky vacation in Colorado, or leisurely cruises in the Caribbean. Sure, Dr. Smith may have a lifestyle most of us only dreamed about, but he is paying a dear price for the lifestyle because he is mortgaged it with his freedom. You see, Dr. Smith has temporary income, but he does not have the freedom to come and go as he pleases. He is chained to his job because he has become a slave to his lifestyle. Dr. Smith has to go to the office every day, whether he wants to or not. If Dr. Smith doesn't show up, he doesn't get paid. And if Dr. Smith doesn't get paid, neither does the mortgage or the car loans or the credit card bills or the tuition to private school. Is it any wonder that so many professionals fall victim to early heart attacks, an accident waiting to happen? Where would the high paid doctor be if he developed arthritis in his hands and could no longer create income because he had to stop working? More to the point, where would you be if you could no longer create income because you had to stop working? Most of us, that's the ultimate nightmare. That's the problem with income creation. It's temporary. If you stop working, the income stops too. And if you don't have any income stream other than a job, you are heading for disaster. According to Business Week magazine, it takes average worker half his lifetime to purchase a home, accumulate some savings and retirement benefits. It takes about 6 months of unemployment to lose it all. Scary, isn't it? Freedom through residual income. Wouldn't it be great if you could enjoy all the benefits of Dr. Smith's lifestyle without the liability of having to go into work if you don't want to? That would be the ultimate dream come true, wouldn't it? Fortunately, there is another kind of income other than temporary income. It's called residual income. And unlike temporary income, residual income keeps earning money whether you show up to work or not. Residual income doesn't fall victim to the time for money trap because it is not dependent on trading time for dollars. To see how residual income is created, let's look at another fictitious professional. We'll call him Joe Jones, CPA. Like Dr. Smith, Mr. Jones have a thriving practice. But unlike Dr. Smith, Mr. Jones fully understood the power of residual income. For the last 40 years of his prosperous career, Mr. Jones saved 10% of his gross income and invested it wisely. Now retired, today Mr. Jones has $1.5 million invested in mutual funds, earning 10% per year, which gives him residual income equivalent to Dr. Smith's temporary income, $150,000. Even though the incomes are the same, what each man has to do to earn money is very different, as the chart below indicates. In temporary income, you trade time for dollars. In residual income, you leverage your time. Temporary income, money grows linearly. Residual income, money grows exponentially. Temporary income, income stops if you are disabled. Residual income, income continues indefinitely. Temporary income, you are not creating true wealth. Residual income, you are creating true wealth. Temporary income, time is not your own. Residual income, total time freedom. Temporary income, you are just getting by. Residual income, you are getting ahead. Temporary income, when work stops, income stops. Residual income, income keeps coming in. Now I ask you, which income would you prefer to receive? Temporary income or residual income? The answer is obvious. Creating true wealth. Wealth creation, as opposed to income creation, isn't limited by the time for money trap because of a concept called leverage. The only way to create true wealth is to leverage your time, money and efforts so that 10 hours of work equals 100 hours of pay or even 1000. You see, the rich get richer because they take advantage of leverage by investing their money over time. As I pointed out in my second book, you can't steal second with your foot on first. The typical millionaire earned his fortune by saving 20% of his income and investing it wisely for years and years. That's the way the rich get rich and stay rich, by putting their money to work for them by investing it over time. That's the big difference between income creation and wealth creation. Income creation is temporary. You have to do the work or you don't get the income. Wealth creation is permanent. You escape the time for money trap by putting your money and your time to work for you, leveraging your time. Now, I understand that very few people make enough or are disciplined enough to do what Mr. Jones, CPA, did and leverage his monthly savings into $1.5 million. Fortunately, leveraging your money is not the only tried and true way to create true wealth. The other way to create true wealth is to leverage your time by investing it instead of wasting it. We have all used the expression, time is money, haven't we? Well, due to the power of leverage, the axiom is truly today than ever before. It's obvious that we do not have the same amount of money, but it's equally obvious that we all do have the same amount of time. Now, I want you to understand that this book is not about investing your money to create wealth. It's about investing your time to create wealth, because time equals money when you invest it properly. It doesn't make any difference whether a person is a billionaire or a beggar. We all have access to the same amount of time, 24 hours in a day, 168 hours in a week, 672 hours in a month, 8,064 hours in a year. The key to wealth creation is not creating more time, which is impossible. The key to take full advantage of time we have. Wouldn't you agree? Fortunately, all of us today, there is a way to leverage some of our time, which we all have an equal amount of, to create true wealth, instead of leveraging our money, which most of us have a little of. Fortunately, today there is a leverage system where you can trade a little time for a lot of dollars, instead of a linear system where you trade a lot of time for little dollars. Fortunately, today there is a simple duplicatable system for leveraging your time and effort that virtually anyone can copycat. Are you copycatting the wrong system? Let's face it. Most of us were not born with the last name of DuPont or Rockefeller. We aren't born geniuses like Bill Gates and Chuck Finney. And we don't have the talent of Michael Jordan or Tom Cruise. All too often, we assume that wealth creation comes from winning the lottery of life. It's only meant for super talented people or super blessed people. But it's certainly not meant for average people like you and me. That's nonsense. We must not buy into that line of limited thinking. That's garbage thinking, and we need to throw that kind of negative thinking out, which the dress starting right now. The truth is that most people assume they can't create wealth when in fact they can. The real reason most people don't create true wealth is because they have never been made aware of a wealth creating system they can copy. In other words, most of us have bought into copycatting the wrong plan, because we are not aware of a wealth building model to copy. We copy what everyone else we know is doing. We take a job we do what most people do, and as a result we get what most people get. Not knocking jobs. Please understand that I am not knocking jobs. I am knocking the results we get from working at a job. If job created true wealth, I'd be the first person to tell you to follow the job track. But they don't. That's just the cold, hard reality of it all. Copycat exponential growth, not linear growth. Truth is, you will never create true wealth as long as you are copycatting the income creation system, because it's based on linear growth as opposed to wealth creation, which is based on leveraged growth. In the next chapter, we will take a closer look at the limitations of linear growth, and we'll discuss why we need to start copycatting leveraged system if we are sincere about becoming totally free by creating true wealth. Chapter 3. Linear Growth. Trading time for dollars. Work all day, live on hay. When you die, pie in the sky. Joe Hill, 1920s union organizer. I used to tell people in my seminars that most workers are on 40 by 40 by 40 plan. They work 40 hours a week for 40 years, and then when they retire, they get a retirement dinner and a $40 watch. But like a lot of things in our fast changing world, the 40 by 40 by 40 plan is outdated. Today, most of us are on the 50 by 50 by 50 by 50 plan. Nowadays, we work 50 hours a week, 50 weeks a year for 50 years, and then retire on 50% of what we can't live on today. Time for money treadmill. The 50 by 50 by 50 by 50 plan is a classic example of income creation because it's based on linear growth. The math to calculate linear growth income is very simple. Hourly wage into numbers of hours worked is equal to income. The definition of linear is the outcome is proportional to the input. In layman's terms, that means you get out what you put in. Nothing more, nothing less. In linear income growth, 1 unit of time equals 1 unit of money. As a result, the only way to increase income based on linear growth is to work more hours or get a rise. Now, at first glance, linear growth seems pretty fair. It rewards people who are paid a good hourly salary and are willing to put in the hours. But the problem with workers earning income based on linear growth is that they'll always have a cap on their income, no matter how much they earn per hour. The painter and the professional. To best illustrate the limitation of linear growth, let's look at two acquaintances of mine with two very different occupations, a house painter and a doctor. The painter's name is Gary, and he owns a small painting and wallpapering business near my home in Clearwater, Florida. Gary works hard. He is on the job early and he works until dark. He works weekend and when he can. When Gary bids out a job, he figures his rate at $12 per hour. But after factoring in travel time, trips to the hardware store and so on, it's probably closer to $10 an hour. If Gary is lucky enough to work 10 hours a day, 6 days a week, here's what he will earn in a year. 1 into $10 is equal to $10 per hour. 60 hours per week is equal to $600 per week. 50 weeks per year is equal to $30,000 per year. Now, $30,000 per year is nothing to sneeze at. A lot of people would love to make $30,000 a year, but that's the most Gary will gross in a great year when one good job follows another. But look at the price Gary has to pay for a great year. He only gets to spend one day a week with his wife and kids. He'll never make more than $30,000 a year, no matter how hard he works. He seldom gets time off, and when he does, he is too tired or too broke to enjoy it. Here's the worst part of working for income based on linear growth. Gary only gets paid once for the work he is done, which means once he gets his last paycheck, he's back on the time for money treadmill. Professionals.
nothing more than high-priced house painters. Now let's go back and revisit John Smith, MD, who earns $150,000 a year in his medical practice. Dr. Smith is a general practitioner with his own private practice, although two of his four full-time employees are registered nurses. Dr. Smith must see his patient in person, so he works 8 hours a day, 6 days a week, attending to patients, then spends 2 additional hours a day filling out paperwork, and spends 2 Sundays of each month on business matters. The only way Dr. Smith can increase his income is by increasing his hours, but because he is already working 10 hour days, by the time he gets home he is too exhausted to help the kids with homework or attend his son's soccer games, much less and more time to his work day. A slave to his job. True, Dr. Smith makes a lot of money, but the trade-off is he is a POW, a prisoner of work. He feels trapped. He is frustrated, angry and unhappy, but he doesn't know what to do about it. So he just keeps going back into the salt mines, trading time for dollars, hoping that things will get better, but knowing in his heart they won't. That's the problem with income based on linear growth. If you are not personally doing the work doesn't get done. If the work doesn't get done, you don't get paid. And the only way to get paid is to keep doing the work over and over again. Heaven forbid the painter or the doctor even gets sick or injured and can't go to work. What does your treadmill pay? What about you? Are you on the time for money treadmill? If so, how much does your treadmill pay? Below is a list of occupations and their average yearly salary. As reported by Parade magazine in its annual report, what people earn. Take a look at how your yearly compensation compares to other occupations. 1996 average salaries for jobs in USA. Occupation, hospital janitor. Annual salary is $17,000. High school teacher, $33,500. Corporate attorney, $85,500. Secretary, $16,000. Sales clerk, $10,000. President of US, $200,000. Newspaper reporter, $32,000. The travel agent, $28,000. Physician, $1,41,000. Prime Minister, $23,500. Accountant, $39,000. Were you surprised at how your income compares to the income of other jobs around the country? Well, you are in for an even bigger surprise when you compare your early salary in the compensation for a CEO of large company. Just take a look at how CEO pay compares to the pay of an average worker in 1996. Wage gap between CEO and workers. 1996 CEO pay is equal to $3.7 million. Worker pay is equal to $20,000. Ratio 187:1. Isn't it amazing how one person at a company can be worth $3.7 million while the rank and file worker at the same company is worth only $20,000? How can that be? You may ask yourself. Breaking the time for money trap with leverage. I can answer your question in one word. Leverage. You see, when a typical worker trades his time for dollars, his income is growing in a linear fashion. Until of time equals one unit of money, the worker is earning 100% of his own singular efforts. The CEO, on the other hand, leverages his time and talents through his employees. Instead of getting paid 100% of his singular efforts, he makes a percentage of all his employees' efforts. That's what J. Paul Getty was getting, and when he said, "I'd rather earn 1% of 100 men's efforts rather than 100% of my own." That's why leverage is so powerful. You earn a little bit from the efforts of a whole bunch of people. A classic example is the Hershey candy bar. Hershey's net profit on each candy bar is only a penny or two at most. but they sell billions of Hershey's bar worldwide each and every year. That's why the maker of Hershey candy bars, Mars Inc., is able to post profit of $1 billion+ a year, year in and year out. And that's why the CEO of Hershey makes big bucks. The Hermit and the Chainsaw. The concept of leverage is like the story of Hermit and the Chainsaw. One day, an old hermit came down from his cave in mountain to buy a saw at local hardware store. "I am moving out of my cave and building myself a new log home," the hermit proudly announced to the young sales clerk. "I need the best saw you got, and price is not an object." The young sales clerk disappeared into the warehouse for a moment before returning with a gleaming new chainsaw. "This is the best saw on the market," the sales clerk said confidently. "It will cut through trees like a knife through butter. I guarantee it will cut a month's worth of lumber in a day, or I'll personally refund your money from my paycheck." The excited hermit paid the clerk, grabbed his gleaming new chainsaw by handle, and headed back up the mountain. Exactly 1 month later, the young clerk was busy stocking shelves when he heard the hermit's voice crack through his ear like a whip. "Hey, Sonny, I've come to return this saw and get my money back, like you promised." The clerk looked up to see the old hermit but was shocked at what he saw. The hermit looked like he hadn't slept in weeks. His clothes were shredded and stained with blood and sweat. He looked like he'd be worked half to death. "What happened to you?" the clerk stammered. "You look terrible." The old hermit summoned all his strength and lifted his chainsaw onto the counter, grumbling. "It's this dead bun saw you sold me. You said it would cut a month's worth of lumber in a day. Well, I've been using this contraption for 30 days, and I ain't ever been able to cut a day's worth of lumber in a month. I want my money back." The startled clerk apologized and said, "Sure, a deal's a deal. Just let me have a look at this saw for you. Maybe I can figure what's the wrong." The clerk gave and pulled rope a quick yank, and the chainsaw exploded into a roar. The hermit jumped back from the counter like he'd been shot, shouting over the roaring, "What's that sound?" A lesson about leverage. Can you imagine trying to cut down a tree with a chainsaw that wasn't even turned on? No wonder that hermit looked beat up and worn out. The story brings home the point that leverage is an awesome tool, but only if you put it into use. The chainsaw is obviously a great tool for leveraging time and effort. If you ever tried to cut up a big tree limb using a handsaw, you know exactly what I mean. The irony of the story is the hermit had in his hands powerful tool for leverage. He just didn't know how to use it. In other words, his failure didn't result from a lack of talent or effort. His failure resulted from a lack of knowledge. The same can be said for the average person. Through the power of leverage, we can accomplish our goals in a fraction of the time with a fraction of the effort. We can, in effect, cut a month's worth of lumber in a day. But in order to take full advantage of leverage, we have to have knowledge that it exists. Otherwise, we'll end up like the hermit. We'll still try to get ahead working harder, trading time for dollars, instead of working smarter by leveraging our time and efforts. Isn't this way, by age 65, the average person will be dead broke, or dependent on the state, family, or church. Too many people are copycatting a linear plan instead of leveraged plan. Knowledge is the first step. By copying the right kind of leverage in the right situation, we can move mountains and we can make millions. The question is, what system of wealth creation do you want to copycat? Do you want to continue to copycat the linear system of wealth creation and end up like the old hermit, trading lots of effort for a little return? Or would you like to be like the young clerk and learn how to turn on the chainsaw for leverage? That's what you will learn in the next chapter. Proven ways we can leverage our time and effort so that we break out of the time for money trap. forever and claim the financial independence that we deserve.
Chapter 4. Leverage Growth. Working smarter, not harder. It is not enough to be busy. So are the ends. The question is, what are we busy about? In August of 1888, an Atlanta druggist by the name of Asa Cadler paid $2,300 in cash for the exclusive rights to a carbonated fountain drink called Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola was an immediate success in the Atlanta area, and by the turn of the century, virtually every drug store in the South featured a soda fountain where a customer could sit down and sip a cold Coke for 5 cents. Then Candler made a monumental decision that would transform Coca-Cola from a small regional company into an international household name. Candler decided his company could make more money with less time and effort by introducing a unique form of leverage, bottling. The secret to Coke's international success. There's a fascinating story behind Candler's decision to bottle Coke. Legend has it that a good friend burst into Candler's office one day and proclaimed that for a hefty fee, he would let Candler in on the secret of vastly expanding Coca-Cola profits. The two men bickered back and forth for a good part of the day until Candler's curiosity eventually got the best of him and he wrote his friend a check. The friend graciously accepted the check and then leaned forward and whispered in Candler's ear with two simple words that launched a global destiny: bottle it. Fortunately, Candler had the vision to make his friend's advice, and the rest, as they say, is history. Leveraging time and location. Bottle it. Just think for a moment about the power of these words. Before Coke came in bottles, you had to go to the local soda fountain to order a Coke, or you had to go without. Before bottling, Coke sales could only grow as the number of soda fountains grew. Bottling changed that all. The consumer didn't have to go to the soda fountain to enjoy a Coke, because in effect, when a consumer bought a six pack of Coke, the consumer brought the soda fountain at home with him. As a result, today virtually anyone in the world can enjoy a refreshing drink of Coca-Cola in this convenience of their home, any time of the day or night, all because of the Coca-Cola company had the wisdom to leverage time, effort, and location by bottling their product. What is leverage? The root word of leverage, lever, comes from an old French word meaning to make lighter, which is an apt description of the power of leverage. By wisely using certain levers or tools, difficult tasks can be performed in a lot less time with a lot less effort, thus making them lighter. Consider the effort it would take to replace an engine in a car without taking advantage of leverage. How many strong men do you think it would take to lift an engine out of your car? 5, 10 or more? Now think about how your local car mechanic could perform the same tasks in a fraction of the time with a fraction of the effort. First, he'd position a well-oiled hose on a steady beam above the engine. Next, he would secure the engine with ropes and chains attached to the hoist. Then he would attach the pull rope to an electric-powered flywheel. With a flick of a switch, the engine could be lifted out of the car in a matter of seconds. That's the power of leverage. It increases productivity by maximizing time, effort, and money. How corporations use leverage? For centuries, enterprising people have been making their jobs lighter. This is more productive and more profitable through the concept of leverage. That's really what increased productivity is all about. Working smarter instead of harder by finding a way to make a lot more money in a lot less time. hiring employees is the most obvious way business owners leverage their time. Virtually every major company in the world, from Ford Motor Company to Sony, started off with a sole proprietor who leveraged his time and talents through employees. If Henry Ford, for example, had built the Model T by himself, he could have pocketed 100% of the profits. But he knew that he would only be able to build a car or two each year working solo. Ford was smart enough to leverage his time and talents by teaching his employees to copycat his system. By taking advantage of the power of leverage, Ford built thousands of cars each year and became one of the richest men in history. Getting real smart selling real estate. Real estate companies have been taking advantage of the leverage concept for years, but instead of leveraging employees, a realtor leverages a team of independent contractors. Let's look at how a hypothetical real estate professional named Ted uses leverage to make more money in less time. Ted has been selling real estate for 20 years or so. When he first started out, he was lucky to sell one house a month. But over the years, Ted got better at his job. After 5 years in the business, he would sell 50 houses a year on an average. But no matter how hard Ted worked, it was impossible for him to sell more than one house a week by himself. After all, he could only show so many houses in a day. He could only go to so many closings in a way. So he decided to open an office. Ted recruited some of his realtor friends to work out of his office. Over the years, as he assembled 20 top-notch real estate agents, each one of those agents sold 50 houses a year, which meant his office was selling more than 1,000 houses a year. Now just look at what leverage has done for Ted. On his own, Ted could sell 50 houses. By leveraging the time and talents of other agents, Ted could sell 1,000 houses, which would be impossible if he were still working alone. By using leverage, he is 20 times more productive while working fewer hours. That's what the expression "working smarter, not harder" is all about. Leveraging through franchising. Franchising took the concept of leverage to an even higher level than a real estate office. Although franchising has been around 4 years, it wasn't recognized as a legitimate business concept until the early 1950s, when a milkshake appliance salesman, Ray Kroc, bought the right to franchise a fast food restaurant called McDonald's. Ray Kroc didn't invent franchising, but he sure perfected it. Kroc understood that the key to a successful franchise was duplication. So he went about setting up a foolproof system that spelled out every detail of a successful franchisee. He even went so far as to spend $3 million to research the secret of consistently perfect French fries. When someone bought a McDonald's franchisee, all they had to do was connect the dots. It was the copycat dream come true. Think about it. When you enter a McDonald's, where is the French fry machine? On the left, isn't it? It doesn't make any difference whether the franchisee is in Moscow or Russia. The French fry machine is on the left, and you better believe every other detail of the operation is spelled out and in the right place too. Duplication, the key to successful franchising. The concept of franchising works so well because it is so simple, brilliantly simple. It's a classic win-win situation where both the franchisor and the franchisee come out way ahead. Through trial and error, the franchisor develops a duplicatable business model built around a proven product like Domino's Pizza or a needed service like Kinko's Copier Service. The key to becoming a successful franchisor is to develop a successful system and then record what needs to be done in a detail so that the model can be taught to somebody else. If a model is proven and can be copycatted by an average person, then it can be successfully franchised. If, however, the success of the model depends on the talent of one in a million star, then it can't be successfully franchised because the star can't be duplicated. Stars are not duplicatable. The reason the actor Tom Cruise can command $20 million a picture is because he is the essence of a star. In Hollywood terms, he is bankable. When Tom Cruise starred in a movie, it almost guaranteed the movie will make money, big money. You can't, however, franchise the product Tom Cruise because he is not a duplicatable. The average person can't copy what Tom Cruise does and accept the same result. That's why you can't franchise creative endeavors like writing a best-selling book or singing a hit song, because they depend on the star factor. They are unique and can't be copycatted. Some products and businessmen, however, are easily duplicatable. Pizza is the perfect example. The ingredients are plentiful and inexpensive. It only takes a minute to turn out a perfect product, and virtually anyone with a high school education or less and a desire to get ahead can learn to copycat the franchise model for Pizza Hut or Domino's. Let's face it, a franchisee doesn't have to be a rocket scientist, but he does have to be a great copycatter for a proven system. From zero to hero. Does the concept of leveraging time and money through duplication work? To answer the question, all you have to do is look at what has happened to franchising over the last 50 years. When Ray Kroc started duplicating his operation, most people considered franchising a scam. The United States Congress even tried to outlaw it. Ironically, the perception of franchising has taken a 100-degree turn since the early days. Experts estimate that today anywhere from 34% to 60% of our goods and services in America are distributed through franchising. And savvy investors all over the world are paying millions of dollars for the right to copycat a proven franchise. The brilliance behind franchising's phenomenal success is the concept of duplication. Through copycatting, the downside to franchising, however, is the startup cost. Let's face it, very few people have $1 million to plunk down for a McDonald's franchisee. To complicate matters, you must own and operate multiple franchises to become truly wealthy in a franchise system. The alternative franchise, the ultimate copycat system. Suppose there were a franchise type concept with a very affordable startup cost, $500 or less. And suppose this alternative franchise took advantage of the most powerful form of the leverage growth known to humans, exponential growth through compounding. What you would have is ultimate copycat system to create wealth, wouldn't you? Today, there is a way for average person to copycat the wealth building system of history's richest people. Today, there is a way to get paid 1000 times for the work you do once, instead of getting paid once for the work you do 1000 times. In the coming pages, you are going to learn more about exponential growth, a proven system for wealth creation that average people like you and I can copycat. And you will learn how the combination of exponential growth and the franchisee concept can empower you to create more personal wealth in less time than any other income system available today.